Well, hello adventurers, this is Elvis Boy with another episode of Into the Sunset, and I am back here at the Rocket Inn Motel in Truth or Consequences, New Mexico, and I'm about to take a tour of Spaceport America. It's the first purpose-built spaceport in the United States, and we're going to go check it out and see what it's all about. Can't wait!
So we are
Spaceport America van, and we're here with our tour guide. Nice to meet you. What's your name again?
Chris Cruz.
All right. We've got some people in the back.
That's right.
We're going to go check out Spaceport America.
Woohoo!
Exciting.
We would drive right into the Ralph Edwards Park. Does that have any significance for any of you?
He was a game show host.
Yes.
Those are consequences.
That, my man.
There it is.
Wow, Matt.
Together. It's all coming together.
And Matt's young.
Heard of it.
That's right. Okay, so with that said, do you know how this town got its name?
I do because I Googled it. Yes.
Okay, so you did the homework.
You tell
me. I will tell people. Here you go. So back in 1950, Ralph Edwards, a national radio show host, started television. And he said to America, whatever township or city adopts the name Truth or Consequences, I will A, give them a cash prize, B, build them a park, and C, I will visit that city or township every year and bring all of my celebrity friends. So Hot Springs, which was it was then, Hot Springs threw their name in a hat, and they were selected by Ralph Edwards and group. Primarily because of the Kerry Tingley Children's Hospital, which then focused on children's polio. And of course, back, pre 1965, polio was a big deal until it was eradicated. So, Hot Springs passed a referendum, let's become Truth or Consequences, locals call it TRC, and hence you have the name. And to his word, Ralph Edwards came out every single year with his celebrity friends until his passing in 2005.
Wow.
That's the little history here about Truth or Consequences.
Wow.
So, and I used to watch this game show host, the game show, which was a little cheesy, and he didn't give away much money on the prizes. I kind of thought they were, kind of cheap. But anyway, in 1956, they hired a young man to now host a TV show. You all know who this young man is. You should know, Matt, since you did some homework, right?
I didn't get that far.
You didn't get that far. Yes, Bob Barker.
I would have guessed.
Bob Barker. Outstanding. All right. It's in tour operator, Curtis Roseman, good friend of mine, I've known for 30 years, asked me to help him with the tours last year. I didn't know anything about Spaceport America. I'd been there a few times when it was still growing, but didn't know a whole lot. And then, as the months went on, I got the bug and went online and I'm looking up all these aerospace companies and what they're doing, and it's neat. And your children are really gonna reap the rewards of this. So, and I'm looking about 10, 20 years down the line, but it's really gonna take off. Okay, so
They're gonna have some kind of almost like an astronaut program going on here.
Yes, as a matter of fact, Virgin Galactic announced that they're going to be building a facility for training for the astronauts, and it's not on Spaceport America land. Okay, he actually purchased, this is Sir Richard Branson, purchased some land that's not with Spaceport America, and mainly because so he doesn't have to fall underneath that umbrella of the New Mexico Spaceport Authority, which is the governing agency that oversees Spaceport America. So he wanted, I don't want to have to follow any of those rules, I want to do my own thing over here, and he's going to build it, and we're going to have some astronauts, and
they need some pilots.
The pilots will come, trust me. They'll come. At least I hope so, because as we all know, with the airlines, part of the reason why they have delays is because lack of pilots. Here we are. So, ladies and gentlemen, this art sculpture is called Genesis. And what does Genesis mean?
The beginning.
Yes, the beginning. The beginning of commercial space flight here in New Mexico. It has that unique U shape because the artist, Otto Rodin, originally is based out of Roswell, New Mexico, created this beautiful structure in that shape as though mankind is reaching up to the stars. It stands 40 feet high, 23 feet across, weighs 2.5 tons, and just cost a mere $200,000. That's it. Pennies. You guys can find it in your couch cushions, right? There you go. Back on October 31st of 2014, out of the Mojave Desert, VSS Enterprise took off with then the mothership, White Knight, reached an altitude of approximately 45,000 feet above the Earth, released the spaceship, and shoo, there goes accelerating into suborbital space, VSS Enterprise, and the VSS stands for Virgin Spaceship. However, 11 seconds into its flight, the craft literally tore apart, killing the co-pilot. The pilot lived, but spreading debris over 32 miles of Mojave Desert, California. Now, they had just put in brand new engines, and they thought that was the problem, okay? When they recovered the engines, they found out, well, it's not the engines. They finally determined that it was co-pilot error. The co-pilot engaged in a technique called feathering. So those vertical wings, they actually tilt up, allowing the spacecraft to slow down, lifting the nose, and to descend into from suborbital space. However, it was accelerating at the time, and that's when it was going forward, pulling back, and that's what tore it apart. Okay, so GTS stands for Gateway to Space. So, want everybody put their creative hats on and tell me what you think it looks like from this view. Come on, guys. There's no wrong answer.
It's like a Rorschach test.
Butterfly. Get that a lot. What else?
Wings.
Yes.
Eyeglasses.
Yes.
The face of a fly.
Face of a fly. Love it. I love it, Mark. What else? Yep. There you go.
I was gonna say glasses.
There you go.
Bra.
A bra, yes. I've had actually two different gentlemen on different occasions,
excuse
and they used
French.
The whole world. Looks like a woman's brassiere.
Whoa, brassiere now.
That kind of like cuts halfway, and it's kind of like.
Mm-hmm. Anyway. We've gotten shoulder pads, a football player, person's bottom, stingray, manta ray, ladybug, all kinds of stuff. So we're turning on to asteroid beltway.
Oh,
Spaceport Operations Center, my man. Go on, Matt.
Gotta go on, Jeff.
And we're gonna hop on out.
Check out. Okay.
Big brain
walk. Spaceport Operations Center, right here.
So I'm gonna have you guys stand on the
going into ops here.
Yeah, here you go, yes.
Mm-hmm. Do you go to the bathroom?
That's so nice.
Yeah, everyone go. I think that's a good idea.
Announce to the world, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to be the first billionaire in outer space, and we're gonna launch July 20th of this year, which was last year. Rumor has it that Sir Richard Branson of Virgin Galactic was filling out registration forms with the FAA to fly in August of last year. But once he heard this announcement, he's like, no, we're not gonna go in August. We're gonna go July 11th, 9 days before Jeff Bezos. And sure enough, that's what happened here. He had a successful flight last year, July 11th, and Sir Richard Branson was the first billionaire out of space. Of course, you know that had to chap Jeff Bezos, you know what I mean? Stole his thunder. So Richard Branson's flight was supposed to be about 90 minutes. I do believe it's about more like 78 minutes, okay? Took off from here. They were supposed to have 5,000 people on the apron out there. However, due to COVID, they had to reduce that number to 500. Yeah, and you're outside. I know why. But had a successful flight. Landed safely, everything was good. 9 days later, there goes Jeff Bezos, okay? So, Richard Branson, they flew 52 miles above the Earth. NASA has determined in their wisdom that true outer space starts at about 50 miles above the Earth. So he exceeded that, okay. And they land, and NASA is here also and gives all four people their wings, Richard Branson and his staff, and they got their astronaut wings. 9 days later, Jeff Bezos goes up. Ah, but he goes 64 miles above the Earth, okay? Exceeding, yes, Richard Branson, so now he has bragging rights. I wasn't the first. Yeah. However, yeah. I went higher for our mission control.
We're going to mission control.
How cool is that? Well, this is quite impressive.
All right, gang. This is Mission Control. Looks nothing like Cape Canaveral, Kennedy Space Center. Banks and banks of monitors, big screen, tracking buttons. Why is ours so small? Two main reasons.
Technology.
Yeah. Yes, technology. Absolutely. Yeah. So your cell phone has more computing power than Apollo 13. Just right there in your phone. Okay. And that's the mission that was, Houston, we have a problem.
Yeah, so we have multiple very different type vehicles. We have this urban interface right here, and wild and urban interface, you know, that's a little bit of everything. It's 750 gallons, 30 gallons of foam. If you look at the front, we Class A foam, which is for your general combustibles. Mm-hmm. If you look at the front turret here, we can operate everything from the inside, actually, and we have like a little joystick. I'll show you in a minute. So that's nice, right? It's what we use for most of our calls. Like, we had a motor vehicle accident on the road, you know, we'll take that out there. And of course, if we don't have anything going on, we do answer calls off site and mutual aid. It just depends what's going on that day. So right here, we have our crash truck. This is a 93,000 pound vehicle.
Wow.
Cost about a little over $900,000. Mm. Each tire on this is actually $4,000.
Oh, yeah.
And it carries 3,000 gallons of water and 550 pounds of dry chemical and 420 gallons of Class B foam. That's going to be for your fuel fires and what have you.
So it's really cool. We have a little escape hatch right there. Put that out to them. A little escape hatch just in case, obviously, worst case scenario. Look at all the visibility all around of us. Wide screen. The driver's literally dead set in the center of the apparatus compared to vehicles and whatnot.
This is awesome. Really, got a really FLIR camera in
there,
too?
Yeah, it has a FLIR. You're able to change the different modes and colors depending on what we encounter. Be able to zoom in as well. Pretty crazy.
Oh, that's awesome.
Man, let's just say, like, we're all over the place and it's all hell's broken loose and we lose the sight of where we're at. Just press home and it directs us right directly in the middle. But yeah, these nozzles right here, this is the captain or this is the company officer, whoever's sitting right here. And the truck needs to be on, but you're able to oscillate. Oh, I guess it does go. So, this one has that ability as well. Moves back and forth. Versus right here, it's gonna be dry chemical. Dry powder. And it's a called Purple K, what we use, and it's literally purple, so there's that little blue line inside it, and that right there has introduces the powder to the nozzle, and you add water with it and it gives it more reach and whatnot. So it's really cool, different applications for different reasons.
So if you guys have a fire, say around here, you guys respond to that as well if you have to?
Yes, sir.
Can this be driven on the streets?
It can. And we've taken to a TRC before for like parades and whatnot, but we literally got to get an escort from PD.
Yeah.
It's a big truck. Very big truck.
Definitely wide load.
Oh yeah. And we it's not terrible. We want to drive it. We would like to drive it in the middle of the street. If we kind of hang more to like a normal driving car, we're going to mess up because it's so much weight on it. We're going to mess up the end of the road.
Right.
So we try to drive it.
Wow, what a monster.
Spaceport UCOM, one vehicle entering spaceway 1634. I'm sorry about that, Courtney. Yes, please? No, it's okay.
What happened? So then you're not considered a state employee.
No, that is correct. So, just like our fire department and our security
guards.
Going
onto the runway.
here we are, gang, on our spaceway, 2.27 miles long, 12,000 feet, 200 feet wide, 46 inches deep, which is almost 4 feet. The first 14 inches are solid concrete, followed by, I do believe, 4 inches of asphalt and then other secondary layers. And you have our fantastic spaceway here. This is it. So unlike a lot of the people, you guys actually get to drive on one, especially this one. Now, to give you some reference to scale, when you land at a typical airport, the airstrip you're landing on is traditionally anywhere from 6,000 to 8,500 feet long. And this one's 12,000. So imagine those race cars I was telling you about zipping up and down. You don't have to worry about any debris, any traffic, any pedestrians, and no cops. You know, you just punch it.
Runway 16.
Now we're going to see how fast this van will go, baby.
Drop the hammer. Not much of a hammer. More like a tap. But back in March, we had a gentleman named, I do believe, Dan Parker came out here in his private Corvette. Okay. Went to that end, the north end, fired up that Corvette Stingray, his own personal Corvette Stingray, zipped down our spaceway and hit a top speed of 211 miles an hour.
Whoa. Nice.
He set a Guinness World Book of Records record at that time.
Interesting, right?
Now, you guys are asking, wait a minute, you told us that the Viper hit a top speed of 260. So how this guy said, you know, Guinness World Book of Records is only going 211? Well, Mr. Parker was blind.
Oh,
he had lost his eyesight about 10 years ago. Used to race cars, but lost his eyesight, and that's why he's in that book, yeah. Alrighty, gang. Yeah. 1 second. Spaceport UCOM, one vehicle departing Spaceway 1634. Okay, here we are at the front of the GTS terminal hangar. So let me tell you a bit about this hangar. It was designed by a man named Jeremy Brown of the United Kingdom, who now resides in California. It has three floors, or three levels, if you will. That top level, where you see that viewing deck or balcony, is used by our pilots and our astronauts, and of course any dignitaries. In the middle section, you have three departments. To the left, you have training for the astronauts. In the middle section, that is for mission control for this building, this hangar. And to the right, you have our medical department. And down below, on the lower level, lowest level, is a lounge slash restaurant for the employees here at Virgin Galactic and their guests. Really cool, huh? And of course, behind all of this is the actual hangar itself. And this building is 100,000 square feet. It can facilitate 2 motherships and 5 spaceships. Alrighty, here we are at the rear of the GTS terminal hangar. And what does GTS stand for again, gang?
Genesis.
We forgot. Gateway to Space.
Oh. We won't forget now.
The birdies.
I've had birds, bats. Okay, gang, so here we are.
Okay.
Top floor of the GTS terminal hangar.
Done.
Oh, I can see. Astronauts will come up here. These two doors behind me will slide open. Beautiful hallway, well lit. They'll walk through. They'll look down. They'll see the mothership, spaceship. Fantastic.
That's cool.
One of the neat things about taking this trip from Virgin Galactic is all of the astronauts will get to keep their spacesuit. Okay, it's tailor-made for them, okay? All their meals are paid for, lodging's paid for, transportation is paid for. So, for your $254.50, yeah. They'll have parties, celebrations, oh yeah. Of course, training, which will happen over here, and all these doors are secure. Okay, so you can't get in. And on this side, you have some offices.
Uh-oh.
Oh, jeez.
We're open.
Hey, we're going in.
I don't think we're supposed to go in here.
Gotcha. I love that part.
Careful. Watch out for him.
This is the top secret area.
Okay. All right, gang. I'll turn on the lights. Please go inside.
Oh. Got a couple of brave troopers are willing to go on this little fun ride. No, thank you. I was thinking, being such a Star Trek fan, I'm noticing the logo for Spaceport America is very similar to a communicator, wouldn't you think? So from Spaceport America in Truth or Consequences, New Mexico, I'm here with our tour guide, Chris. It's been a fantastic day. Anything you want to say about Spaceport America?
You know what? This is such a spectacular place. This is just the beginning. So I urge everyone, while you can, please come out here, visit Spaceport America, because within a decade, this place is going to be literally taking off. Hope to see you soon.
Absolutely. So from Spaceport America, remember to embrace those positive things, get rid of the negative things. Life's too short for anything but joy, and we'll see you next time.